Good afternoon. Welcome to another session, week 9 for the NPTEL course on applied optics. This week we were introduced to the concept of Fresnel diffraction and Fresnel half period zones. So the questions this week are pretty simple and straightforward. They are mostly factual type questions, not many calculation or derivation type questions. So if you have any further questions, please feel free to stop me and ask, unmute yourself, or you could put it up in the Zoom chat box. And before proceeding, let me put the link to the YouTube channel for this course in the chat box. So this YouTube channel is where you will find all the previous sessions, previous problem solving session recordings. So if you have happened to miss any one of the sessions, you could go to the YouTube channel and watch the recording over there. Also, each of these problem solving sessions are also live streamed on the YouTube channel. So if you face any issues in Zoom, any network issues in Zoom, you could head over to the YouTube channel and watch the stream over there as well. Okay, so let us get started with the questions for this week. So the first question is, the expression of the obliquity factor is what we need to find out. So I will start the poll. Please take about a minute or two to answer. Okay, so let us now discuss the answer. So the correct option is, let me first tell the correct option. The correct option is option D. And this obligatory factor was introduced in the Huygens principle to get the Huygens Fresnel principle. And it was introduced to prevent back propagation. So when theta equals pi, then the obligatory factor known as, it's represented by k theta, then k theta is 0, so there is no back propagation of the wave. The wave only moves in the forward direction. Okay, so let us now proceed to the next question. All the point sources within the area of a Fresnel zone are option A, coherent, option B, incoherent, option C, partially coherent, and option D, none of these. So I will restart the poll. All of you please attempt the poll. I request all the students to answer the poll. I see that some of you do not do so. It is for your benefit only if you answer the poll. So it is a good habit to try and attempt the question before I discuss the answers with you. Let us now discuss the answer. The correct option to this question is option A. All the point sources within the area of a Fresnel zone are coherent. They are coherent only then they add up and we see superposition and diffraction effects. Next question. It is also on obliquity factor. The zero value of obliquity factor signifies that A Okay, so I'm restarting the poll. You have a few minutes to answer. Let us now discuss the answer. So this is a question similar to the first question of this week on obligatory factor, and we discussed it in that question as well. So the correct option is option B. Energy is not propagating in backward direction. And this obliquity factor is comes up in Huygens Fresnel principle. And if you look at it, the other options do not make much sense as well. Energy, if the energy does not propagate in the forward direction, then we will not have any wave propagation at all. And wave vector is not perpendicular to normal of the wave front. Wave vector is perpendicular to the tangent of the wave front. So if I have a wave front like this, then at this point, if I want to find out the wave vector, I'll draw a tangent. And perpendicular to this tangent will be my wave vector. Okay. So that's that. Moving forward, as you can see, very simple, straightforward, factual information based questions. There's nothing much that we have to do over here in this assignment. It's either you know it or you don't know it. There's nothing that you have to calculate to find out. Mostly definitions. All these are like definitions. This one is on the definition of a Fresnel zone. Like, there's nothing that we can possibly solve here. Either you have read it and you know it, or you don't know it. Okay, so this question is, Fresnel zone is also known as what? I have refreshed and relaunched the poll for all of you. The correct answer to this question is, let me change the color of my pen, half period zone. And why is it called a half period zone? Because phase difference between successive zones is pi, and pi is half of a period because the period is 2 pi. So that's the reason why it is also known as a half period zone. Moving forward to question number 5. A Fresnel zone is divided into 5 subzones . The phase of each subzone would be option A pi by 5, option B 5 pi, option C 5 pi by 2, or option D 5 pi by 4. Take about a minute or two to answer the poll. Okay, so this was a very simple numerical, hardly a numerical actually. Actually, this week the assignment problems, I'm not really very happy with them because there isn't much stuff in these assignment problems to do. But still, anyway. So, each period, as we saw in the previous question, each period constitutes a phase of pi. So, if there are n subzones, then each of these subzones would make up a phase of pi over n. N over here is 5 because we have 5 subzones. So that means each subzone would have a phase of pi by 5. Simple and straightforward. Next question. Again, a question on Fresnel half period zones. Phase difference between the center of the first Fresnel zone and edge of the second Fresnel zone is what we need to find. Very simple question. So, if any of you have any questions, please ask right now. We have a lot of time because these assignment problems are not all time consuming. The correct option to this question is option C. Answer is 2 pi. Why? Because it is pi for each zone. So the first zone is pi, then we are looking at the edge of the second zone. So that means we are crossing the second zone as well. So as a result, pi plus pi, that makes it 2 pi. Next question. Last Fresnel zone. Does not contribute to the vibration curve because A, obliquity factor is 1, B, obliquity factor is 0. C, there is backward wave associated to last Fresnel zone. Or D, it is in phase with adjacent Fresnel zone. Okay, so the correct answer is option B. Obligatory factor is zero. And to remind, obligatory factor is given as 1 plus cos theta over 2. And if I put in theta equal to pi, which is for the last zone, then this gives me k equals 0. Next question. Fraunhofer diffraction is Fraunhofer diffraction pattern is observed if A Fresnel number NF equals 1, B Fresnel number NF less than 1, C Fresnel number NF greater than 1, or D Fresnel number NF equals 5. So the Fresnel number NF is given as follows. Where R is radius of aperture, rho is distance from source to aperture, R naught is distance from aperture to screen, and if NF is much less than 1, then then that means that very small number of Fresnel zones are in the aperture. As a result, we do not really see Fresnel diffraction, we see Fraunhofer diffraction pattern. Question 9. If we move away from the aperture, then the number of Fresnel zones, option A, decreases, option B, increases, option C, remains invariant, or option D, none of these. The correct option, as we discussed in the previous question as well, is that the number of Fresnel zones decreases if we move away from the aperture, and that is when we slowly start entering the Fraunhofer regime. So if you move very far away from the aperture, then the Fresnel number is very small. Fresnel number very small means that there are very few Fresnel zones in the aperture. That means the number of Fresnel zones in the aperture decreases as we move further away from the aperture. So, last question for the day. This was a pretty quick, short assignment. If the first Fresnel zone is obstructed by the circular disk, then which one of the following is true? A, amplitude of the field at point of observation is increased . B, amplitude of the field at point of observation is decreased . The amplitude of the field at point of observation remains same or D, amplitude of the field at point of observation is decreased by factor of half. Last question for the day. I will activate the poll for one last time. Correct answer to this question is option C. If the first Fresnel zone is obstructed by the circular disc, then the amplitude of the field at the point of observation remains the same. And this means that we have same irradiance. Same irradiance meaning same diffraction pattern. And this is what is known as Babinet's principle. So Babinet's principle essentially states that we will see same diffraction pattern, same diffraction pattern for obstacle and aperture having the same shape and size, same shape and dimension. And this is true when we are in the Fraunhofer regime. Fraunhofer regime meaning when we are very far away from the aperture. So this is Babinet's principle, which states that the diffraction pattern that you see, whether you have an obstacle or an or an aperture of the same shape and size, then you see that the diffraction pattern is same. Meaning, if I have a circular disc or a circular aperture, then my diffraction pattern would be the same Aries pattern when we are definitely when we are in the Fraunhofer regime. So this brings us to the end of today's session, the session on week 9 of NPTEL's Applied Optics course. And mostly this week we were introduced to the concept of Fresnel half period zones. That was the most important topic taught in this week. And we saw that there were questions in this week's assignment based on Fresnel half period zones. And the questions from this week are very simple and very straightforward, very factual, informative kind of questions. Nothing very tricky or tough in this week. So if there are no questions, then this is the end of today's class, and we will meet in the next class for week 10. Okay, so that is all from my end. Thank you very much. See you next week, next Saturday at 3 p.m. So our classes are every Saturday, 3 p.m. to 5 p.m. 2-hour classes. Okay, someone is asking that they do not have the link to the YouTube channel. Okay, so I will put it up once again in the Zoom chat box. Let me copy paste the link. Okay, there you go. So that's the link to the YouTube channel. Even if you are not able to copy paste this, if you just search in YouTube Prasad Radhika, that's my name, then you would be able to find the YouTube channel. Okay, so that's all from my end. Bye bye. Thank you. So, if you do not have any questions, please log out from this Zoom meeting. Oh, someone is asking for a reference book. I think I mentioned it long time back, but I would repeat myself. So, a good reference book would be Ajoy Ghatak's book on optics, and another good text, pretty much standard text, is Eugene Hecht's book on optics. I'll put it up in the chat box. So these two are very standard texts on optics, and you could refer any one of them.